Hello everybody, my name is Yana Horakma. I was introduced here for a couple of times already. I come from Brno, from Masaryk University, Faculty of Arts, and I teach at the department focused on the theory of interactive media. It means like new media art. And my personal interest is in early stage of robot history. I call it like archaeology of media, focusing to the cultural history of robot. First of all, I would like to thank to Christian for inviting me and for the big job he did, or hard work he did for this festival, because like Danish man had to come to Czech Republic to organize something like this. So really thank you for doing all the work. And now I would like to introduce Karl Čapek's robots. I will talk about a robot which I understand as the central figure of narratives or discourse of technological progress. And I will talk about these early stages of the development of this discourse, which are connected with Prague. That's why the heart comes to the center of Europe. So I will talk about robot. Is it better? Yeah. About the character and the neologism coined by brothers Čapek. Joseph Čapek suggested the word to his brother Karl Čapek, who is here on a caricature made by Joseph Čapek with the official first night of the play date on his chest. It's January 25, 1921, when the drama Are You Are You? Rozum's Universal Robots was first staged at National Theatre here in Prague. On the right side, you see a book, like the book with Are You Are Rozum's Universal Robots, published in the end of the year 1920. Again, the author of the cover is Joseph Čapek, and I think that the globe on it is significant because it refers not only to the subject of the play, which is a drama, utopia, which take place not only on the island where the utopian factory which is producing artificial workers is based, but these robots are selling to the whole world, and finally these artificial creatures don't kill only their creators but the whole humankind. So that's why it's like global utopia or global dystopia. But it's significant for another reason too, because the word robot and the play RUR get international fame very, very quickly. As you can see on the left side of my poster, there is a list of varieties or mutations of the word robot you can find in supplements of Oxford English Dictionary in 1933 already. Like robotized, robotizing, robotization, robotry, robotism, robotain, robotesque, and so on. František Chudoba referred about it in a Czech newspaper with commentary that the word robot has a richer cultural life in foreign countries, especially in the Anglo-Saxon cultural context, than in Czech Republic already in that time. So I will focus more to this, not only to the word robot, which you can only read the word in the book RUR, but I will focus on these first embodiments of robots on the stages of theater, National Theater, and then these early first nights in the capital cities of the West world. So please. Another slide, yeah, thank you. So this is a poster of the first official first night of the play RUR, which took place in National Theatre in Prague, as I told you already. But maybe you don't know that there was another, like, real first night of the play that took place in Hradec Králové. It was staged by amateur group Klitspera in the municipal city theater, and it happened at January 2nd, 1921 already, because they were like faster in the preparation than the official National Theater. And even though these representatives of the National Theaters tried to stop the first night, they were not successful. So we have like two premieres of the RUR, unofficial and official, let's say. So it's small joke from the beginning of the history of RUR. But this first night is or stage production is interesting for us for a couple of reasons. The director Vojta Novák was chosen by Karel Čapek himself because they cooperate on his previous drama staging already on this Rubber or Low Patient in Czech. Stage designer Bedřich Feuerstein was a young architect who studied in Japan before, and he really tried to make like futuristic stage full of colors with symbolical meanings. And Joseph Čapek was the author of costumes, so he was not only suggested to Karel Čapek the name of these artificial workers, the robots, but he also helped to embody or to give them the appearance to these artificial creatures. So please, just another slide, please. So it is the drawing by Bedřich Feuerstein, the stage design, how it should be. It was not such a colorful, in fact, but it was his plan for the staging. Another slide, please. And here you can see these officially first robots, how they look like. I think that also it's significant that we have only these two images of these robots from the first night in National Theater. It's from Atelier, it's not from the stage production. It's pity that we don't have any visual material which would serve us to know something more about it. And its second robot, Karl Váňa, who was the main organizer of these photographies of these robots, and the robotess Sula. So you can see quite not something futuristic, rather like deprivated man and a woman. But Joseph Čapek followed the instructions which were written in the drama by Karel Čapek already. So another slide, please. Because Karel Čapek wrote that in the prologue, the robots are dressed like people, their movements and speech are laconic, their faces are expressionless, and their eyes fixed. In the play proper, they are wearing linen shirts tightened at their waists with a belt and have brass numbers on their chests. So it's exactly like the words are exactly reproduced to these images, you can say, or to the costumes. So another slide. The play was big success. It was really like blockbuster of theater, but it's not very usual that theater plays are such a famous and such a popular. But it doesn't mean that all theater critics were evaluated or appreciated the play. It was not quite contrary, but there was quite a lot of negative critiques, which has something common. They blamed Karel Čapek that he wrote the play not because he needed, because he as artist needed to say something to work, but that he was playing with the fashionable motifs of the time, and just use them to make the play for an export. As the play for an export was the main reason why to do this this play RUR. As Miroslav Rute wrote in 1933, Čapek was often rebuked that the success of RUR was based on the period atmosphere, calculated views, and thus his drama was just kind of skillful handling of the public demands. Or Karl Taige, again, they are mostly left-oriented avant-garde artists in Czech, wrote that maybe we should replace Czech neologism, kitsch, or kitsch, with another new Czech word, RUR. And Arnold Dvořák wrote that great kitsch, which will be soon translated into German and probably to English too, and will start its triumphant way to all contemporary theaters of Europe, except Russia, where, for example, Mystery Book by Mayakovsky is in demand, but everywhere else has given kitsch legitimacy and role. Why shouldn't such great kitsch go far? And these voices were right. It was really very popular, and the play was something that was used for export from the young Czechoslovakia, young country. But that's something that I dealt in my book, that I don't agree with these opinions that it is a kitsch, in fact. So next slide, please. It's true that the man-machine was not something new in this time. It was really peak of industrial revolution. These man-machines, or these men represented as a geometrical figure, it was quite common, and avant-garde artists used it quite like in constructivist, cubist. On Bauhaus stage, you could see these geometrical figures. In Russia, this constructivist, is, for example, Vsevolod Meyerhold had these biomechanics as exercises for actors who should behave like part of like cogwheels in the big mechanism of the stage production. So it was really that man-machine was not something new. And another slide, please. And when you compare these quite radical examples of treatment of the man-machine on the stages and Čapek's robots, it seems like Čapek did something like, it was not, he was like inspired, but at the same time it was made for like official stage, like national theater, something for the bourgeois audience that will accept it, and it will be not so provocative. And of course that left-oriented artist criticized them that this man-machine was something which was used in that context of art dedicated to these new utopian visions of revolution, of new worlds, new social settings and so on. But I think, and another slide, that we should read the drama different way. It's true that Karel Čapek knew very much about what's going on. His brother Joseph was inspired with cubism and futurism also. And but Karel Čapek was quite intellectual artist. He was not so much like emotive, like two kinds of artists, and he played. He played in the play with a theme of man-machine, which was usually, especially in futurist discourse, treated as something like hero, as Superman, as somebody. So he played with these motifs, but with a kind of distance and irony. And it's true. It's one thing is that when there is irony and distance, it never can be kitsch. It is play about these themes that can be like these universal motifs as love, peace, or other universalities, as Milan Kundera wrote that these are usually like themes that are treated as a kitsch. but Čapek played with it with kind of irony and humor. We can find, or we can understand his approach when we compare his robots, for example, with this figure, or this drawing. It's from his brother's brother Joseph Čapek book Homo Artefactus, and it's Prague Golem. It's not kind of like monster with like embodiment of these deep mystical powers, but it's rather like just man from a clay, some like doll, something that is not to be. We are not afraid, or when we see this kind of golem. Another another inspiration, or we can compare this attitude, is Charlie Chaplin's movie The Modern Times from 1936. It's also kind of, there is a sense of humor and irony when he represents these modern times for us. So please, so here is Karl Čapek's example or quotation from Karl Čapek. Article in Prague Tagblad, where he explains his relationship between robots and golem. RUR is in fact a transformation of golem legend into modern form. However, it came up in my mind only when the piece was done. To hell, it is in fact golem, I have said to myself. Robot is golem made in mass factory production. So it's kind of a golem serially made. Something that is not like mystery, but something that is just product to be sell. So another slide, please. So here is example that of the famous expressionistic film by Paul Wegener, Der Golem from 1920, and the Golem in like version by Joseph Čapek. Another slide, please. And here is. Another not so much known inspiration for robots for Karl Čapek, and the inspiration was just citizens of Prague traveling in the morning to their work. And he wrote that robots were a result of my traveling by tram. One day I had to go to Prague by suburban tram, and it was uncomfortably full. I was astonished with how modern conditions made people unobservant of the common comfort of life. They were stuffed inside as well as on stairs, not as sheep, but as machines. I started to think about humans not as individuals, but as machines, and on my way home, I was thinking about an expression that would refer to humans capable of work, but not of thinking. This idea is expressed by a Czech word, robot. So this is also shoot from the Chaplin Modern Times, these sheep. It's not from like farmyard. So it's another less known inspiration for his robots. Next slide, please. Yeah. What is another specific feature of Čapek's robots is we can find when we will use like semiological approach. It means that we will ask how Čapek represents the robot. It is not drawing, it is not literature, like letters, it is not sculpture, it is a drama character which should be presented on the stage of theater. And there are certain specificities of this kind of art, because you can differ between visual artist and his drawing or sculpture. You can differ between stage designer and the stage setting, or director and the stage production, but you can't differ between actor and the drama character, because actor as an artist makes the figure from his own body and personality. So these robots are made really from organic matter, even it's a transposed to this imaginary reality of the stage, of theater stage. So that's this is the way how we can also understand these words Čapek wrote in the prologue of the play when Domin, director of the factory, is explaining to Helena Glory how these robots are made. So, and then Miss Glory, old Rosen, wrote among his chemical formula, "Nature has found only one process by which to organize living matter. There is, however, another process, similar, more moldable and faster, which nature has not hit upon at all. It is this other process by means of which the development of life could proceed that I have discovered this very day." Imagine, Miss Glory, that he wrote these lofty words about some phlegm of collodion jelly that not even a dog would eat. Imagine him sitting over a press tube and thinking how the whole tree of life would grow out of it, starting with some spices of worm and ending with man himself. Man made from a different matter than we are. Miss Glory, that was a tremendous moment. So this is the organic robot made from my own body. So next slide, please. Yeah. And as I told, the play was very successful, and this first night or staging and translation of the play was almost immediately. So I will now show you robots from different cultural contexts, from the stage productions of RUR in New York, London, Berlin and Vienna, and in Paris. Because I think that it was these robots we will see now, which helped to us or help people to understand Čapek robots as these artificial workers, as something that is made from what is played by actors, because we don't have these robots yet built. So it was really like it's artificial machines or artificial humanoid machines. So please, another slide. So here you can see robots from first night in New York at the Garrick Theatre, where Theatre Guild group under direction of Philip Moeller staged RUR. It was very like modern theater, concentrated on the European production. Stage and costumes were done by Lee Simonson. You can see much more like futuristic stylization of this robot. They have same haircuts and so next. Yeah, and here you can read some reviews from referring to this New York stage production of RUR. One of these reviewers wrote that, like H.G. Wells of an earlier day, a trip that exceeded even Jules Verne's wildest dreams, RUR is a super melodrama, the melodrama of action plus idea, a combination that is rarely seen on our stage. You can see here the title RUR, fantastic play of man-made monster, and even the drawing shows these robots like twice as big as normal persons, even though it was like actors, of course. So next slide. And here is, so, well, it was too fast, one before. Here, yeah. It is an image from the first stage production of RUR in London, April 24, 1923, in St. Martin's Theatre, director Basil Dean, stage and costume George W. Harrison. You can see these robots looks like that they are in armor. They look like knights, and they directly inspired this real first mechanical robots too. So next slide, please. Thanks. Yeah, and here is again drawing from the review of the RUR production in London. You can read here, "Fall of Mankind, the robots take possession," and here you can see the audience terrified with these robots that are really approaching them from the stage. It was a big success in London again. Next slide, please. They even organized a public discussion with political figures of of the United Kingdom or England. G.B. Shaw, for example, told in this public discussion, what is a robot? A man or woman whose activities are imposed by somebody else. A robot is not allowed to be original. He is not even allowed the luxury of original sin. All the people in this audience are robots. I do not think here could be a more typical assemblage of robots. Those of you who think that the real robots are factory workers are entirely wrong. You have become robots by listening to the subsidized press. Let me be a robot for 2 hours a day, but for the rest of the day, let me be Bernard Shaw. For those 2 hours of robotism, give me a mechanical job so that while I am turning the wheel, I can think about the next play I am going to write. So it was really a big discussion about this robotization and about the meaning of robots all around the world. So next slide, please. Less known stage production of Arnar was in Berlin and Vienna. In Czech Republic, I think that nobody knew about it till I started to search for these capital cities and first nights. It is important for us, especially because of the stage designed by Frederik Kiesel, member of Der Spiel group, and important avant-garde architect. The staging or the director, John Gotthoff, made quite conventional, even expressionistic staging of RUR, where these two sides, like robots versus mechanism that was moving all the time. And it's probably the stage production where was for the first time used film on the stage, on the theater stage. So he used also different optical equipments to make illusion of this utopian factory. Even he used so-called Panagras system of mirrors to represent these robots, which were even like not on the stage, but behind the stage, and they were only like projecting by the mirror on the stage. And he had kind of theory called co-realism. He believed in art that is able to connect us with like actuality, with virtuality, or the real with our imagination. And I think that on the level of the staging, which was not convenient with the directors, staging is really original and important part of the discussion of the meaning of robot. So next. And here is the Paris stage production from 1924. It took quite a long time to make the stage production in Paris. It was not such a big success as, for example, in London and New York it was. It was for a couple of reasons. They had no money for the big stage production. They wanted originally to make the RUR with 100 robots on the stage, but then they decided to make it like smaller. And French people make it kind of like conversation or love story between Domin and Helena, and somewhere behind were a couple robots. So it was not so much successful, and quite often in these reviews, French reviewers mentioned that it is not original theme. But of course it's not original theme, it's one of the oldest themes even from Bible, I don't know. So I think it's not the reason that why it was not such a successful. I think it is because of the staging, the conventional staging. So next slide, please. You can see again drawing from one review where you can see that in the front are this love story of Helena and Domi, and somewhere behind the robot only on the horizon. So next slide. So here we can recapitulate that here you can see all these different robots from New York, London, Berlin, Vienna, and Paris. These robots, these man machines, This is the next slide. Okay, I don't know. I changed these two slides. I was not sure which one put first. So just show me one bag. No. You will show them all this prize. Yeah, here and the next one. You can. Okay, yeah. And all these robots help it to these Chapex robots to become not like ironical commentary to this man-machine hype of these times, but to make them more like artificial humanoid creatures which can help us to make this world better, to replace people in, or men in hard work and so on. It was something that, it was this kind of robots which soon were replaced from these theater stages to different like short stories, like science fiction stories and science fiction novels. And this kind of robots were criticized by Isaac Asimov, who calls himself the father of robot story, who wrote that during 20s and 30s, R&R helped straightening Frankensteinian complex, hordes of noisy and murdering robots appeared in one story after another. He was quite critical to Chapex robots, but we can say that maybe it was for purpose because there was some kind of competition. Next slide, next new slide. As I told you, this robot functioned as an important figure of these narratives of technological progress. As Roland Barthes told or wrote, that this myth, it was kind of myth of industrial revolution, myth of technological progress, and myth tends to become reality, to become true. And it's true also about Chapex robots. Very soon there was like effort to really build them. So next slide. This was a robot, Eric from UK, you can see the connection between him or between it and RUR robots, because he has this RUR on his chest. And it was supported by Captain Richardson, and Eric was the main attraction of the exhibition of the Society of Model Engineers opening ceremony in London 1928. And he was able only to stand up, sit down, little move, and maybe something not to say but transform some speech. But it is, you can see even in this armor that he really resembles these robots from UK stage productions of RUR. Next slide, please. Next. And here is from the same year, Mr. Telebox from USA, with his inventor R.J. Bensley. Here you can see that this robot is in fact only like, it's that Telebox machine which is pretending to be robot during its advertisement. So, next slide. And for the second half of 20th century, there dominate this definition of robot, which is not anymore like satire about the man, like man which who is like mechanized, but it's really like artificial creature. Robot is machine plus computer, according to Isaac Asimov, who is also inventor of the word neologism robotics in his short novel Run Around in 1942. And I think the context of the robotics helped the real development of this, or the thinking about how to make, or for what purposes to make these artificial creatures called robots. And also we introduced these three laws of robotics, so these robots became not so much dangerous, but rather really servants or toys or whatever, friends of my, so, or nannies, whatever. Yeah. Jean Baudrillard wrote about these robots, that they are these mechanical robots, that they are not expression of the state of humanity in the machine age. It was originally called Chapex robots. They are results of projection of desire for endless production and reproduction, symbols of industrial production expansion. And here you can see Honda's humanoid robot Asimo, who is laying a bunch of flowers at the bust of Karl Čapek in the National Museum of Prague in 2003. So it's like an image from Czech newspaper. And the next slide, please. Yeah. And reaction of Karl Čapek to these mechanical devices called robot. So it's not an author sport what can be called the world hype with robots. The world needed mechanical robots. Hence the author asks for something that nobody can deny to him. The honor that he was defeated. So we can say that there is not only one robot. There is many robots with the same name, with different purposes, and but the whole complex makes this this world so fascinating and so inspirative to think about it. What it can, what else it can be, or what it was original, and why it was changed. So another slide. That's something that deal with artists working with robots, because. Robotic art is, I teach like new media art, I see robotic art as kind of subversive strategy in the new media discourse, because the new media discourse leads towards virtuality, the disappearance of interface, and or that we all will go into the cyberspace and we will leave our bodies behind. But robots are different. They are like material, and they come like into our space, and they confront us with their difference, otherness, and ask for some reaction. Here you can see examples from the robotic art manifesto by Eduardo Kac and Marcel V. Antunes Roca from 1997, who tried to not defined robots in art, because it's really so complex that it's not possible to define it. It's more like manifesto for to make robotic art. And I will not read it because I think I'm right. but maybe next slide. Yeah, and here is a quotation from Mitchell Beitler's book Metacreation, where he mentioned exactly the function of robots in art. They come to our to space here, and it's real interactivity they need from us. So next slide, please. And now a couple examples of robotic art, where I see some connection with Karl Čapek notion of robot. It's a Jiro Miyata by Momoyo Toremitsu, New York-based Japanese artist. And maybe you know this work of art. She performed with this middle-aged businessman in different capital cities in the capitalistic part of the world, like in New York, in Australia, I don't know where else. And he's like trembling on the streets, and she's waiting for direction, especially for the reactions of the pedestrians. But the meaning of this hyper-real robot is that she criticized that the capitalistic maybe way of this basis of the capitalism, which is competition between people, that they are kind of these armies of these robots fighting to each other because they have to. So this is the principle of the capitalist system. So it's kind of, he's kind of something between like soldier trying to be like invisible, and someone who maybe makes us sorry of him because he's like this. And it really, the art is our what we think about it, how it changed our attitude. Next slide, please. Here is an example of Czech robotic art by Krzysztof Pintera called Revolution from 95. These robots you can find in hidden corners or somewhere on different places, and he's just beating the ball. And you can interpret it as kind of deprived child who's doing all the time the same movement. Or you can see it like kind of a revolution into which we don't believe anymore in this post-historical era, because it's something that is like young people who are just beating to the wall without but there will be no change. And this is an example of robotic art by Martin Britsey from Slovenia. It's Robovox, Your Voice from 2008. And it's like 6 meters, I think, tall sculpture. It's a sculpture, monument, but I would call it like anti-monument. You can send to it SMS and he will speak your opinion publicly. I have still his number in my phone. And it's kind of an anti-monument in the sense that he tries to tell us opinions of these many, not only of the one woman. Next slide. And last example, again, we come back to Prague for inspiration. It's a robotic performance. It's not anymore like a humanoid robot, but it's an openly machinic robot by Philip Demes and Bill Byrne. It's a robotic performance called The Trial, inspired by a novel by Franz Kafka, Prague Citizen. The performance they call some sort of dramatic post-industrial poetry. If I talked before that the robot is a figure of the myth of industrial or technological progress tends to become like reality, then the opposite movement we can find in modern poetry, which goes like which tries to destroy the level of the language of semiotics of language and goes deeper to these essentials, to these places between worlds. And this is something what these robots can give us, this kind of experience. I have here like DVD, like short example, but I don't know if we have still time to present it, but we can see this robotic art, which I like because it's like openly machinic performance. So you can show last slide. Thank you for your attention, and I will show you this trial then. And it's my book about RUR and robots. Unfortunately, in Czech, I hope I will get some money for translation. So thank you for your attention. So.